We have a quorum. Can I get an approval of minutes for the regular meeting of July 6, 2011?
Move to approve.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Now we have a presentation by Commissioner Larry Sufferdin. Welcome. We're glad to have you here.
Thank you and good evening, and I appreciate the invitation. Am I the first of our group of four to come before you? You know, in, well, I mentioned to some of you, Will Met throws a breakfast in which they ask everybody who represents any part of Will Met to come. So we're there with the three school districts and the park board and the library board and the village board. And then the state reps, the Congress, they had two members of Congress. I guess they will not have two members of Congress because under the new map, Jan will represent all of them. And I always describe the competition between their three school districts. You know, when I first started going, Avoca was giving laptops. Then District 39 had to give laptops. And then Nutrier had to win every sporting event in the last 8 years I've represented them. And then the coup de grace was, at our last one, they won a Grammy. So unfortunately, I can't tell you that the county has won a Grammy, that we've won any sports events. But I come here as someone who has a little different perspective than my office mates on Davis Street, in that the county, like the city, is a home rule unit. And so we have certain powers. We're the only home rule county, so we're kind of unique in our use of our home rule powers. But we get to use them the way that you get to use your home rule powers. And we are creatures of the General Assembly. So the my roommates, the senator and the state rep, have a lot to do with determining how county will deliver services to people. I'd like to just kind of talk about a couple of the key services that the county is providing to people. You know, for a lot of folks, county government is stealth government. Really, nobody really knows what it is we do. Today, we passed an ordinance to say that we will no longer accept detainers from the Immigration and Customs Service. And, you know, so we get, in running a jail, we get into kind of very different kind of issues than you get into. But of the services that you're interested in, the first one, the collection of property taxes and dispersing them back to you. We will be at least 2 months earlier than we were last year. It seems clear that the treasurer will have tax bills out maybe by the third week of September, but definitely by the 1st of October, due on November 1st. That being the case, we should have money and revenues coming to you in early November. And I think that that's one of the things that we continue to strive to work on to have the clerk of Cook County, the treasurer of Cook County, the assessor of Cook County, and the Board of Review of Cook County working together to get all of the assessment information done. Now, for next year, Evanston has just been reassessed. We've gone through the process of the assessor putting out those notices and putting out appeals. We've gone through the Board of Review. So hopefully by next year, we will have the assessment process at a point where they can get this out by September 1st, which is really what the statute requires. Yesterday, we announced that we will go online with doing appeals for both the assessor and the Board of Review. One of the things that many of you know is that I've done them in this room, held seminars for Evanston residents, and have a couple of lawyers on my staff whose job it is to help citizens deal with their assessment issues, deal with their exemption issues, and we'll continue to do that. But as we do more and more online, I think we'll be able to get these done faster, which means our part of the assessment process will be done sooner. The one thing that I think all of us need to watch, and I think we need to work together on figuring out how we appeal it, and that is what is known as the equalizer or the multiplier. The State of Illinois Department of Revenue puts that number on there, and while we can fight to keep our assessments at a reasonable level, that multiplier has been over 3, and that means they're saying that our assessments are 300% below what they should be. That's because the idea is to equalize it with the rest of the state that does not use a system that has percentages of value as the basis for the classification. Most of the rest of the other 101 counties have no classifications. But we've never been able to appeal that multiplier, and that multiplier has really been used to the disadvantage, I think, of our residents. And we need to try to figure that out, because I think that will help us stabilize housing prices and other things as we go forward without affecting the actual cash received by the municipalities, the school districts, park districts, and other entities. So we'll be working on those processes going forward. Evanston is fortunate enough to have, because Dwight Perkins lived here in Evanston, the smallest forest preserve and one of the first forest preserves in the county, Dwight Perkins Woods, which is in the 7th Ward, and Mark and I have been out there doing work in it with our local stewards and some of the neighbors. Dwight Perkins lived on Lincoln Street. The whole forest preserve movement started in his living room on Lincoln Street, and because of him, we now have 68,000 acres of land. Perkins Woods is a delightful place. There are two things that I am trying to get done in our capital plan for the next year. One is to repave the crosswalks and to put permeable trails in there. I happened to be in there the other day and saw an older person with a walker who was having a difficult time on the paths because the roots of the bigger trees have forced these paths to be uneven, and I think that we'll be able to do that. The second thing is some time ago, probably about 1991, you may remember when we were told to disconnect our downspouts from the sewer system by the MWRD, Evanston cemented up the sewer that was put in Perkins Woods, thinking that that was a way to disconnect it from the sewer system. Unfortunately, we had put drains into Perkins Woods. Perkins Woods is built on an underground creek, and Mark knows this because the area around there is really swampland because it is this underground creek is there, and almost every house there has some kind of story about the way they've stopped their water leakage in their basements. Well, this we put these drains in to try to drain some of the swampiness of the area back somewhere in the late 70s. And it's been one of my concerns in the North Suburban Mosquito Abatement District baits this area on a regular basis, that we have sewer lines in there that don't go anywhere because they were cemented up. And so one of the other capital plans I've asked for some money for is for our ability to open that up so that we can drain that. And I think that while we haven't had any West Nile virus issues in Northwest Evanston the last 2 years, we had previously had some. I can't tell you that they're from the Forest Preserve because no one knows where they came from. There are people who have the theory that it's the deep tunnel, which runs over by Lincolnwood School, that those mosquitoes live the winters way deep and then they come up. But we will try to do something to deal with the drainage issue over there, and that'll stop water from coming over on Grant Street. The third thing that we deal with is public safety. And we have, through our Department of Homeland Security, a number of federal grants that come to us and then money that gets spent down to local police departments. And Evanston has been part of the badge program and a number of other grant programs. We have a command vehicle, which is basically a huge RV vehicle, which is used during the football games and other big events in Evanston. It's stored in Glenview at the center out there that deals with Homeland Security issues. And we'll continue to try to gather as much federal money as we can to have those kind of resources available, along with the sheriff having a dog squad, a bomb squad, other specialty police bureaus that none of the local police departments can afford, and the sheriff and I are committed to making sure those are funded each year in our budget. The final area where we overlap is on health care. Evanston is one of seven of the original collar communities that had its own certified health department. Skokie is another one in our area. Evanston and Skokie are the two in this general area. The other communities really do not have a certified health department. Now, when those were done, the idea of these seven, and they were the bigger communities, they were Cicero, Berwyn, Oak Park, River Forest, Thornton, that these communities were the bigger communities. They were the original suburban league high schools, if you followed those teams in the 50s and 60s. And the idea was that these communities needed to provide more services than the other communities, the Wilmettes and so forth. As time has gone on, that distinction really hasn't made a lot of difference. And we have situations like when you downsized the public health department, we had expected that Cook County would take over some of those services, and then there was some dispute over grants. Now, at that point, we were operating under the Todd Stroger era, and I just mention his name, and people nod and say, okay, I understand. We now, though, have our public health department operating under the independent health board at the hospital, who also has public health. And I think that one of the things that it's time for, and I'm hoping when the new CEO starts October 1st, Dr. Raju, who's coming to us from Brooklyn, where he has run one of the city hospitals in New York City, that he will sit down with communities like Evanston and the other certified health departments, and we begin to figure out how we put together a delivery network using the resources that you have with resources we should be able to get and other resources we ought to be able to bring in to look at a number of the issues that are out there on public health, both on the educational side and on the treatment side. I know the mayor and this council has worked really hard to get an FQHC. FQHCs are clearly the way to go. We have in Rogers Park three FQHCs that have really made a difference. And so I'm hopeful that we will see eventually an FQHC here and that we can figure out ways to help tie that into a public health network. And so I've talked to Ms. Thomas and have been at meetings with some of you on some of these healthcare issues, and I think that that's a place where we need to work together on. So that's kind of a general overview of county services as they relate to Evanston. Let me talk about the county budget for a second, because all of us who are in government realize that budgets become the key problem. I started keeping a chart as each budget year started, and now I'm in my ninth year. And John Stroger always started with a shortfall of $550 million. He was very consistent for the 4 years that I served with him. His son was consistent and starting at $500 million. For three of the 4 years I served with him, his fourth year, thinking he was going to be reelected, he started off with a shortfall of zero and immediately had a balanced budget. President Preckwinkel, by the way, it didn't help him get reelected, in case you noticed. President Preckwinkel last year started at $550 million, which was an interesting number that she picked because it was where John Stroger did, and then she whittled it down. This year she has started at $315 million. And we're whittling it down. I call these the miracle that happened, as all of a sudden that shortfall has gone from 315 to 215 and eventually to zero. But our budget is actually in pretty good shape. We have some surpluses. And the reason we're in good shape is that we've never missed a pension payment. We have probably the best in the Forest Preserve and the county, the best two funded public pension funds in the state. We need to figure out how we can use our financial strength, which is there, to help communities around us. In Chicago, we use it through the Public Building Commission. We do not use the Public Building Commission in suburban areas. And I think that there's no reason why it couldn't be, because the county, the Water Reclamation District, are all part of the Public Building Commission, and it is a vehicle for doing capital programming and I would hope that once we get through our next budget, and the president has said she'd like to pass it before our budget year starts on December 1st, which would be only the second time in my 9 years on the board that we would pass it before our budget year started, that we then would be in a way to sit down and look at budgetary issues and especially capital plans that we could do together. And then one last footnote, we have to do redistricting. You have to do redistricting. We did not put any money in our budget this year. Our plan is to redistrict next year. I would expect that my district will stay fairly much the same as it has been. Where there will be changes is the part of Northfield that I represent and the part of Maine Township that I represent, but I think Evanston, Nutrier, and Niles Township and 49th and 50th wards of the city of Chicago will pretty much make up the nucleus of this. I'm looking forward to working under the new legislative map with the two newest members of the Evanston legislative delegation, and I would hope that you will get to know them. They're both exceptional women. Heather Staines is the senator, and Kelly Cassidy is the state rep. And since I represent the parts of Rogers Park that they represent and also represent the parts of Evanston that they represent, I really look forward to working with them on issues and figuring out how we make Howard Street an asset to all of us in Evanston and that we deal with some of the issues that a boundary never stops. And I think that having two people who whose districts under covers Howard Street, and that's the only part of Evanston they have, I think will give them a unique opportunity to have a focus where our other reps and senators are in a position where they have to deal with demands from other townships farther north that are very different than Evanston. So I hope you get to know them and you'll get them in here and get them into your rotation of talking to you, even though it's a small part of Evanston they represent, but I think they're both very exceptional people and both have a good knowledge of the budgetary problem. Senator Staines chairs one of the Appropriations Committee, and Representative Cassidy, before she went to the General Assembly, worked for the state's attorney for the last 7 years and was involved in a lot of their community outreach programs. I'll stop there and take questions, and I welcome the opportunity, if you have issues, to bring them to us, and we'll be glad to try to participate with you.
Thank you, Commissioner Sufferton. It's always good to see you, and I'm glad you're here with us tonight. There is a layer of government between us, between municipal city government and Cook County, and that's the Evanston Township. And I wondered what your thinking was about Evanston Township as we who sit as trustees of the township will be undertaking a larger discussion about the township, I think, when we reconvene as township trustees in a couple weeks. What's your thinking on the township government? How would changes with township government affect services the county provides and so forth?
Well, the interesting thing, I talked about the health departments that were certified health departments. They are all in coterminous townships. And again, there's only a small number of these coterminous townships. And I only represent one coterminous township, and that's Evanston. I actually see no reason for a township government in a coterminous township because we have a municipal government and the functions of a township, when you don't have roads, and we don't have a road commissioner, so we don't have roads, are fundamentally to run through the supervisor, the general assistance program, which is a program that may be better run if it were run on the municipal level where because of your community contacts and outreaches, and the outreaches you already have in other departments of this government, probably would be stronger than having one person with a small staff separated from this building over at Maine and Dodge. The second function is the assessor's function. And as someone who worked hard to help the current assessor get elected, and the reason that I did is that I found it very difficult to work with the prior assessor. And one of the things that we found is that one of those functions in that assessor's office is to take the building permit information that Evanston has and to communicate that in a format to the assessor so that when it is appropriate for the assessor to put those improvements online and increase the assessed valuation of property, it gets done. And unfortunately for Evanston, there was a huge backlog when assessor Wilson came into office. But again, I think that that's a function that easily your building department could perform. And I think we can figure out, as we go online and do more things to help people appeal their assessments, work on their exemptions, between my office and some, maybe absorbing one or two of the staff people that are currently in the assessor's office, we would be able to do that. And I think we'd end up saving some money doing away with one layer of government. You know, Illinois is the state that has the most levels of government of all the states. And in a coterminous situation, the township government to me doesn't make sense. I would hope that you, as the trustees, would look to figure out how we do the referendum to deal with this. Now, I have to tell you, my belief is a little bit different in the other townships I represent, where I have multiple communities, because they are very different. Now, of all the communities I represent, only one has a highway commissioner, and that's Northfield. And I actually represent an unincorporated area of Cook County at the corner of Lake Cook Road and Waukegan, where all the roads in the subdivision there are township roads, not county roads. And so the township plays an important role in those highways. But we don't have those considerations, so I think we have an opportunity here to help reinvent government and put something together. And I think that Supervisor Vance does a very good job, and I think that the Assessor Wilson does. But it's really a question of that form of government was set up for a different era, and today, in a coterminous situation, I think we can do something better.
Any other questions? Commissioner Suffredin, how many buildings would you like to have as joint capital projects with us?
Well,
How about Robert Crown?
No, I think that this is something we need to look at.
I'm ready to look at it.
You know, the Public Building Commission, I just today got my report. They send me a report, and the Boone School, which is being built in the 50th Ward, is the only project I currently have in my district. But the 49th Ward has a new fire station and a new public library. The 50th Ward has a new fire station. There's a new park building at Gale Park. All of those are public. They were not built by the Chicago Park District, by the City of Chicago. They were built by the Public Building Commission. And I think we need to sit down. If we are going to be creative about government, and we're in a unique position with Senator Schoenberg in the position he's in the Senate, to look and see if we need to tweak the statutory authority, there's ways of doing that. And the ability to use a different vehicle for the financing of these kind of projects, like we do use the state to finance some sewer projects, don't we, Mr. City Manager? You know, so there are examples where you can use another government to get a capital project here. And it just seems to me the Public Building Commission is one of those things we need to be looking at.
I would love to look at it with you as soon as we can make our schedules meet.
Yeah, and, you know, I did go with the city manager and the mayor to talk to Forrest Claypool, who is my former colleague on the county board, about transit issues. And you know, I think that that's another area where we need to constantly work together on, because the county gives $2 million a year to the CTA, but nobody in the county has any ability to influence the governance of the CTA. The story goes that in 73, when they created the RTA, they were $5 million short, and that Mayor Richard J. Daley called up George Dunn and said, I'm putting $3 million in, the county's putting $2 million in. And since 1973, every budget has $2 million for the CTA. I get to vote on Metra appointments, on PACE appointments, and on RTA appointments, because suburban commissioners are part of the governance structure in terms of appointing the members. And I've been able to get a Metra person from Evanston. Bill Widmer has been on the Metra board for the last 2 years. I think that if we work on transit issues together, it's another area. And I think our meeting with President Claypool was positive, because he needs support and help for the whole red line expansion, which includes the purple line, and figuring out ways to make it more efficient so that people want to ride it. So, Mayor, I look forward to those kind of interactions with other governments.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you so much for
coming.
I'm glad to have come, and I look forward to seeing all of you at various community events. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have a presentation by the Human Relations Commission.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Lori Ecker, and I'm chair of the Evanston Human Relations Commission.
Could you come to the podium? Otherwise, the camera can't pick you up. Oh, sorry. Was that a bad thing to say? It'll be fine.
I think the Human Relations Commission in Evanston has undergone a number of changes over the years, and most of us on the commission now are fairly new to the commission, having been named just in the past couple of years. And when I first came on the commission, they had recently developed a program that they hoped to kick off as far as doing community mediation. And that idea apparently was done without the knowledge of the council. And so we reached a point where we needed to reinvent ourselves. And so we took a look at the code. And here's what the code provides as far as the purpose of the Human Relations Commission. We had a community meeting last November and asked a variety of community members who attended what they would like their Evanston Human Relations Commission to be doing. And we had a small but very enthusiastic group and took those ideas back to the rest of the commission and developed action steps that we thought would meet the needs of the community and fit in with what we are tasked to do by the code. And once we developed a list, the commissioners voted on what they thought should be the high priority items. And the number one list that most of us agreed on was to develop a community-wide asset map and master calendar. I think, speaking for myself, that kind of knowledge base will empower us to know exactly what is being done in the community so that we don't overlap with tasks that are being completed by other organizations, but it'll also give us an understanding of maybe what isn't being done by the community. So that's what we're starting with. We'd like your permission to do that, to have our concerted efforts on reaching out to the community, letting them know that we want to be the repository for that type of information, get it online so that everybody in the community knows what events are being done in the community, and so that we know who these organizers are and can network with them and hopefully get some strength in that information, probably for the next couple of years. But most of the commissioners are anxious to get started on a project, and this is the one where we could all agree that we could put our efforts into. Several of the commissioners were present at the community picnic. We have given our support to the Peaceable Cities 9/11 Walk and Talk that will be occurring on Sunday. And we're hoping that you'll give your nod to us proceeding with the community-wide asset map. Here are very energetic commissioners who are anxious to get started on the project.
Do we have any questions? Alderman Grover?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Ms. Ecker, very much. My only question is, an asset map, is that to be a tool for use by the commission or for the community at large?
I think initially it will be something that we figure out how to get started with. There have been a couple of other organizations in the community that have started one but haven't had the manpower to complete it. So we're hoping that with staff and with our intern, we'll be able to get that job completed. And then The idea, I think, is that once that gets started, then we can get it online and work with our IT people to figure out how to make it an interactive process, but also have some guidelines in place so that, you know, not everyone can post anything on there that, you know, won't be monitored by someone. But
any other questions? No, I thought the report was outstanding, and going really through the action steps and looking at the different areas, I was very impressed. Thank you. Next on our agenda is Grant Farrar to talk about codifying guidelines for citizen comment.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the committee. Grant Farrar, Corporation Counsel. With respect to the proposed ordinance that's before the Rules Committee tonight for discussion purposes, I think really you can boil it down to four words, the goals of this ordinance. And really it boils down to clarity, consistency, transparency, and civil discourse. In my research on this topic, and I've been very interested in this topic for a number of months, I discovered that most of these similarly situated communities in Illinois that are similar in size and similar in demographics and similar in citizen engagement levels, most of them, if not all of them, frankly, have citizen comment guidelines codified in their ordinances. And I think that's a very wise and advisable approach, because what that is able to do is give everybody, members of the council, members of this public, and people watching on TV, just the roadmap. In the text of the proposed ordinance that's before you tonight for discussion, really what I tried to do is take past custom and practice with respect to the 45-minute cumulative rule on citizen comment, the 3-minute individual limit, and some other components that are already set forth in the sign-in sheets and the council rules and just the custom and practice, and put those to paper. But also, what I also tried to do is take common sense, reasonable time, place, manner restrictions that have been upheld by the United States Supreme Court, by Illinois state courts, and by federal courts in Illinois, and apply those approaches to this ordinance such that we can have a very concise document but very complete. So what I've tried to do is lay out, I believe there's 10 different steps relative to citizen comment, and hopefully it would give everybody a good roadmap for informed dialogue, for maintaining civil discourse, and for advancing the agenda, the important matters that are discussed by council at all meetings. I'm happy to take questions.
Do we have any questions? Alderman Grover?
Thank you again, Madam Chair. I'm still stuck on the question of why we need an ordinance, why we need to codify our rules that are clear and available and online to anyone who wants them, that are reproduced in our agenda for every city council meeting, and why we need to put this in our ordinance, that is what we expect and hope from the citizen participants in our meetings. That's just my first question.
Well, for example, if you look at the ordinance, and specifically with section 12, which is on page 7, it talks about council committee member responses. That language really restates language that's already found in the council rules, but it's in two different sections of the council rules, section 6.5 and section 10.6. Then you have the sign-in sheet, which also has language in there speaking about civil discourse. It restates the 45-minute limit. So I think that for purposes of really engaging our citizens, which is a top priority of the council, as well as maintaining transparency, I thought it might be advisable for the council to consider a one-stop shop, in effect, such that this ordinance has all of the rules relative to decorum and public discourse in one place. All citizens are able to understand it, and that the city can, going forward, really have a transparent and open port of call if when folks want to know, okay, what are the rules, or what are the guidelines?
Could we amend our rules to achieve that kind of clarity, consistency, transparency, and encouraging civil discourse? And if we do codify this, would it make our rules irrelevant? Would we be taking that out of our council rules if it becomes codified?
If the ordinance were adopted, Alderman Grover, I would suggest some text amendments to the rules. But really, the rules themselves, it would be a hand in glove conforming the rules to an ordinance. And of course, it's a rule of statutory construction, and it's even set forth in the Evanston Code of Ordinances that an ordinance governs over council rules if there's any sort of conflict. But it would be relatively easy to put everything together. I also might add that the virtue of an ordinance is that it's fully part of the council's legislative deliberations, such that the council is making a legislative record. This discussion obviously gets put out on the airwaves, but it's also part of the council minutes, such that I think that from a legislative standpoint, it might serve the city well to have that legislative record. You can't necessarily do that when you're talking about amending council rules. That's just a little bit different. But here we have five pages of rationale, and then we have discussions related to an ordinance.
We could also pass a resolution simply restating all the rationale behind all the whereas clauses, the rationale behind the time, place, manner restrictions on citizen comment without codifying these specific rules, which, as drafted, give us no leeway to expand citizen comment beyond 45 minutes for extraordinary deliberations or extraordinary circumstances. And I'd like to see more discussion, more in our rules about civil discourse and how we encourage mutually respectful and effective advocacy, and how we would follow those very same standards ourselves. The ordinance is drafted is a list of all the things we don't want in our discourse with citizens when they come before us, but not the list of things that we do want and things that we hold ourselves to. Yes, we do have some prickly, annoying citizens who come to share with us their opinions, and they're and can be rude and uncivil and inappropriate sometimes. But frankly, in the 2 years I've served on the council, I've heard the same from this council podium. And I'm really looking for us to model the kind of behavior that we hope and expect from the citizens who come to speak before us, and not simply require it without the same expectations on ourselves.
Alderman Wilson?
And that's not directed to Mr. Farrar, I'm sorry, but I think perhaps as a predicate to an ordinance that requires certain behavior of citizens during citizen comment, perhaps we could also reflect upon our own way that we treat those citizens who come before us, and whether we accord them the kind of respect that they deserve.
Alderman Wilson. Sorry.
Thank you. And I guess in some ways it's probably unfortunate that there's a perceived need to have to codify, I guess, what constitutes decorum. I haven't seen any dramatic examples of severe problems or things of that nature in the 2 years I've been here. I do have some specific things in going through the draft ordinance. The lawyer in me can't resist, right? But I think generally speaking, and to Jane's point, we have a lot of shalls in the codification, and it doesn't provide us with a lot of flexibility. Business shall commence no later than 45 minutes after the beginning of citizen comment. I'm concerned that could be turned around and used against us, for lack of a better term. You know, we might have any number of things could come up. We could have some sort of presentation in between, and someone could raise that as a point of order. We're not following the rules. And again, there could be extraordinary circumstances where we want or need more comment time. And I think that the chair of the council meetings or the committees should have some discretion and some leeway in adjusting to the circumstances. So that's kind of my general sense of things. If there were a way to tweak the rules to make it more clear and to set forth those expectations so that people don't proceed in an incorrect fashion. And I'm going to guess, for the most part, anybody who comes to the meeting, signs the sheet, they take a quick look at the sheet. They might not even read it. But again, I haven't seen any dramatic displays of severely inappropriate behavior.
Alderman Holmes?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to respond first to Alderman Grover. I think that that you're correct in terms of the council and the behavior of the council, but I think that would come under council rules rather than here, because these are guidelines for citizens' comments rather than our own conduct, which certainly can be, taken care of. So, I mean, that would be my thought in terms of taking care of that. My only thing about this is that for the 45 minutes, I think that's fine, but I'd not like to see us break it up where we'd have agenda items and non-agenda items. I'd like to have citizens' comments and just be finished with them in one swoop, rather than having to come back later. You know, maybe, and it doesn't say, it said maybe, and I understand that. But I think if we have that in there, that people will begin to say, well, let's put that until later. So I'd not like to see that part added. Other than that, that's fine with me.
The other lights? My only comment is, I've mentioned this previously about citizen comment when incorrect information is given versus just comments by citizens, and what do we do about that when information that's clearly wrong is going out across the airwaves and we are not responding to it to set the record straight. I'm not sure if that would be part of this or another part of our rules, but I think it continues to be a problem that we aren't addressing.
Don't we have the option of asking the city manager to correct that?
But it's not. It's part of. If we're going to do it, it's part of citizen comment. I'm saying, should we add that in here as well?
It's there.
Oh, is that? Did I miss it? I'm sorry.
I believe sorry. Section 12.
I apologize. I thought I read through it looking for it and missed it. Thanks. Mr. Bobkowitz?
Yes, Madam Mayor, members of the committee. I think I'm hearing a couple different things from you. I think that there's a willingness to perhaps tighten the procedures for the comment, but perhaps not go as far as the use of an ordinance to do that. I think one of the concerns that we have as your staff is that absent something more formal than your rules, we potentially open ourselves up to individuals coming before the council feeling that their rights are not properly exercised. And without having something in the code, that causes some dilemma for us potentially further down the road. And you hire your corporation counsel to worry about such things for you. And so I think that's where that concern comes from. Is it something we're facing? And clearly many of you, and I would agree, in my 2 years here, we don't see that level of concern, but I think it's out there and something for the council to think about. It may be appropriate for us to take back the language here, to go back to your rules, and perhaps propose some adjustments to the council rules, and perhaps look for something, codification that perhaps is a more of a middle ground, so that there is something in the code, because as Mr. Farr said in reviewing the city codes of other communities around Illinois, there is at least some language that is not currently in the Evanston code, so perhaps there is a little less precise language that we could put in the code, but would also then protect us for the time when individuals would come and say, well, you're not allowing me my free speech, and where is that protected in the code as it might be in other jurisdictions. So we could come back to you with taking some of this as a revision to your rules with a pared-down revision to the code, because I do agree with Mr. Farrar that some language would be appropriate and prudent, but perhaps not to the extent that you see in the proposed ordinance.
So, everyone
light on?
I'm sorry, Alderman Nguyen.
I think it's an interesting discussion. Since I've been on the council, Alderman Rainey isn't here tonight, so I've been here the longest. I was here when we had no time limits and it was wide open in terms of what could happen, what anyone, how long anyone could speak, or about what they could speak. On at the podium, and 45 minutes was seen as a very, very stringent limit. But I think that it's useful for citizens to have something codified that's easily accessible, because many times people have asked me what they can do, what's the proper procedure. They want to make sure that they can be very effective when they come before the council. I agree with some of the things that Alderman Grover said in terms of shalls, and it felt somewhat stern to me. I'd like to have a little bit better information about what other municipalities do. So that would be my question, is to have some understanding of what are the other communities that have it codified in this way.
You want us? Alderman Tendem?
Thank you. I would like to see what would come out of the city manager's suggestion of really going back and focusing on the rules, and then using taking a more general approach to codifying something, picking up on what exists in our ordinance and maybe what some other communities do that don't restrict it so much at the ordinance level. That's, I think, a good direction to go.
I see no further lights.
So, Madam Chair, members of the committee, we'll take that as general direction and come back at a future meeting.
Next item on the agenda is from City Manager, revision of Section 9.9.3 of the City Council Rules References.
Yes, Madam Chair, members of the committee, at an earlier City Council meeting, this item was referred to the Rules Committee regarding references. Currently, Section 9.93 of the Council's rules read as follows: Committee, boards, and commissions composed entirely of aldermen shall consider matters referred to them by the mayor, aldermen, or staff without the necessity of a vote of the Council. References by individual aldermen to standing committees can be made at the call of the wards, during individual standing committee meetings, or communication to the committee chair by an individual alderman. Representatives to references to other committees, boards, or commissions which are approved by the City Council shall be considered by that committee, board, or commission. Prior to the approval of such reference, the Council shall have the right to debate the motion for such references. As you all are aware, the standard practice really is one of two ways for the Council to refer an item. It's either through the call of the wards or to the committee chair. And I think this was brought up by Alderman Fisk a few weeks back, focusing really on those two type of referrals. But if the Council is interested in making an adjustment, it would be to this section of the Council rules.
Alderman Fisk?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yeah, the idea behind this is just to make sure that both the committee chair and the committee members of the various committees are aware of references as soon as possible, so that we can be thinking about ordinances that may be coming forward to us, and so that we don't end up with an ordinance in front of us with such short notice that we haven't had time to either think it through or prepare. This happened at Human Services earlier this year, and I think we just need to communicate better among ourselves.
Other comments? I think it's been working pretty well overall of how to get things on the agenda, but I'm not sure why we're making a substantial change.
No, this language is existing.
Oh, okay.
This is just existing language.
But do you want it to be more?
Right. What? I'm sorry. I turned my light on. What I'm suggesting is that when an individual alderman makes a reference, especially to a committee chair, where it's not public, where the rest of us don't know that the reference has been made, that reference be communicated to the full council as soon as possible. In the case of the dangerous dog ordinance at Human Services, I didn't, and I'm assuming other committee members didn't know about this until the Thursday before the Human Services Committee. And at that time, we were told that there had been work on the part of an alderman through a reference for over 6 months. And I think it's just, it helps us work better as a team and as a council if we're all if we have as much warning as possible that there are going to be issues that are going to be presented. I think that's as much a good business approach as it is courtesy to one another.
Alderman Holmes?
I don't think it means a change in the language here. I think, again, we need to go back to our rules, our council rules, to discuss these kinds of things. I really do, because the language to me is fine. But I understand what Alderman Fist is saying, but I think that we need to look within our own council rules to see if it couldn't be adjusted that way rather than changing the reference, I think.
Alderman Wilson?
Maybe just something as simple as something along the lines of, in the weekly packet, a list of the references or something like that have, you know, been made during the week, and that each week we'd have a summary and know what's new.
And Madam Chair, members of the committee, if that's the wish of the committee and the City Council, I would just ask that the committee chairs keep me apprised. And if the committee chairs keep me apprised, then we could do a memorandum when we're aware of that. So we could certainly try that. And if that informal procedure works, great. If it's not, then perhaps it's worth coming back and revisiting at some later time. But I'll be happy to, if the chairs make me aware, I'll make sure the council is made aware.
We have under new business, and I know we have one speaker, Paige Finnegan. Paige, could you just introduce who you are and why you're here?
Yeah, Paige Finnegan, 525 Elmwood. I am co-chair of the Environment Board with Susan Besson over there. And I'm going to read this off my smartphone, so if I'm not making any eye contact, I'm sorry. But Honorable Chair, members of the committee, recently in the Environment Board has been working to address issues relating to sustainability and the multimodal transportation plan. Of particular interest to us are issues of bike accessibility throughout the city. As all of these discussions and decisions flow through the Transportation and Parking Committee, we would like to explore how the Environment Board can gain a seat on this committee. It seems reasonable for there to be an Environment Board representative, considering the tremendous impact of transportation on our carbon footprint, 14% of total city emissions per the Evanston Climate Action Plan. And we're here tonight just to explore how that can happen.
Can we hear from the Parking and Transportation Committee Chair?
Yes, that's me. Hi, Paige.
Hi.
I'm going to echo probably what Alderman Holmes is going to say, is that this probably should be referred to the Rules Committee. I don't have any objection as a member of the Transportation Committee, but obviously it should be discussed by the Rules Committee.
Hence our presence this evening.
Yes. Yeah, so.
You drew an
out. Right.
Right. Alderman Grover.
I think it's a great idea. I think we're doing a lot of stuff as we enact and follow through on our multimodal transportation plan, a lot of which is geared to green transportation and proximity to transit. And I think it would be really helpful to have somebody from the Environment Board represented on our Transportation Parking Committee. Parking and Transportation Committee? What's it called? Transportation Parking Committee. Thank you.
I don't see any other lights. As also a member of the Transportation and Parking Committee, and since we also haven't had a quorum the last time, it would be helpful to have also someone from the Environment Board. A different take on transportation would be very helpful. So if everyone's in agreement, we can put this on the October agenda to discuss.
Mm-hmm. We do our rules.
Yes, right. Rules. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Great. That sounds excellent.
This
and
meeting?
This, yes.
Thanks.
And may I just say, Madam Chair, that we actually have, I think we have at least one position open on the committee right now.
It appears that way from the website that there is a vacancy.
There is a vacancy.
We'll come back with the particulars at your October meeting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. I think while there is a vacancy for me to appoint someone, I need all of you to okay someone from the Environment Board.
Right.
Because you're not allowed to serve on, I can't appoint the same person to two boards.
Right.
No,
there is,
right.
So I need you all to.
Right. Alderman Fisk?
My suggestion is that, and tell me if how this works on other committees, but that someone from a board be an ex officio member to that committee and therefore be a non-voting member, but it's very helpful to have the information as part of the discussion.
Yeah, I know when I was on Plan Commission, I was on Community Development as well as the Plan Commission member, so.
And likewise with the Economic Development?
Or zoning
have
board.
A member from the Plan Commission on that committee.
And the Transportation
and
Committee
there
has
a overlap. Transportation as well.
The Transportation Committee has a member of the Plan Commission.
So October meeting? Mm-hmm. Everyone's, is that okay with you, Mayor Tisdale, as well?
Sure.
It's great. An excellent idea.
Thank you.
Thanks, great idea. Any other new business?
I wanted to report briefly because we did a year and a half ago agree on a legislative agenda, but I just don't think ComEd got mentioned at that time. So I wanted to briefly update everyone on what I have done while we have not been meeting. I have signed a letter asking that the federal transportation funding be reauthorized or we won't have any money to fill potholes in the city of Evanston. I have also agreed to lobby the state legislature to have ComEd have more accountability in their bill if the governor, as we believe he will, vetoes it. And the Northwest Municipal Conference is still working on pensions. That concludes my report. If I'm doing anything that anybody feels is not part of the legislative agenda we agreed to, please let me know.
Keep up the good work.
Absolutely.
Anyone else? City manager?
Yes, Madam Chair, members of the committee, we put at your desks tonight two items regarding our community outreach for the budget process. One is a postcard that we're going to be making available throughout the community, encouraging folks to go to our website to participate in a budget survey. People can also send us emails, call us on 311, participate through Twitter or Facebook. We're also have produced a budget survey, which has a sort of a summary of the work that we've been doing, plus a calendar. And on the back of that survey, asks people to give us their three service change ideas that we should pursue and three that we should not pursue. This will be included as an insert in the next issue of the Evanston Roundtable. So hopefully, in addition to all the good work we do, I think on the internet, there are still many people who are more comfortable having pieces of paper. And so we hope that this will accommodate that need. So this will be in the issue, I think, coming out next week, Sean, right? Next week.
Alderman Fisk?
Thanks. Does the roundtable, is that delivered to high-rise apartments, high-rise condos? What's the
depends on the management of the company.
Oh, okay, so the various buildings need to contact the roundtable in order to enter into an agreement. Okay, because I think there's a large group of residents who live in the downtown who never see the roundtable. And perhaps other condo buildings as well, so.
But they're in the boxes, they could pick them up.
Yeah, but lots of people don't pick them up out of boxes. We're used to seeing them in front of our houses.
We've enabled, in order to get this in the round table, I think it's 18,000 of these are being printed. So we're also getting some extra. So we will have some available. So if individual aldermen are aware of either multifamily buildings or other areas that we should make these copies available, please let us know and we'll make those copies available.
Any other new business? Can we get a motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We need to reconvene as City Council.
All right. City Clerk, we need you to call the roll.
And then going into exec.
Right.
You got to reset.
But since we're here.
We have to convene first.